Okay, still on the theme of using Spark as a plug-in instrument, we're going to do a little sub-chapter now on using the effects pad to write control moves in when you're using Spark as a plug-in, okay? Sure, the effects pad. Okay, the first thing to note is that the roller effect doesn't work at all to write control data. Okay, it doesn't. None of the roller functions work. The main roller function is to write notes, to do roll notes for an instrument. So, for example, if I choose pattern A1, come on, switch. Okay, the whole way it's supposed to work is you select an instrument, you choose roller, okay. And then you put your finger on the pad, for example on eighths, and then press the snare pad and it will write a roll for the snare. But what happens is this, you put Spark's pattern sequencer into record, hold down with the pad and roll. But what happens when you do a roll is it actually writes the roll notes into the pattern sequencer as notes. Okay, so the roller doing its primary function, which is writing rolls for instruments, for drums, it doesn't write controllers, it simply puts notes into the pattern sequencer of Spark, so that obviously doesn't write controllers. If we're using Spark as a plugin, we would write those roll notes into the patterns on the track. Okay. The other roller effects don't work either, and I'll just show you why they don't work. We need to look at this software, the GUI. Now we know from the plugin chapter that the six parameter pots, the channel strip pots here, okay, we know that they write control data if you move the pots here in the software with the mouse, but the actual physical pots on the hardware, those six pots don't write control data. But the odd thing is that the roller has three other modes, right? MP1, which is a matrix of the cutoff and resonance. Okay, then it has MP2, which is a matrix of the two auxiliaries. It just moves the two auxiliaries together as a pair, either together or opposing, like that. And it's the same with the cutoff and resonance, look. It can move them together, up and down, or opposing, opposites. Okay. Like that. And then it's the same with the roller mode MP3, which moves the pan and volume together as a matrix pair, either together or opposites, like that. Okay. And the strange thing is that while these pots here, these controller pots, if you move them with the mouse, they do write control data. Look, I'll put automation on. Okay. Just turn the volume down a bit. Watch, I'll move these pots, and they all write control data when I move them individually with the mouse. Control data, control data, control data, control data, control data, control data. They all write control data individually, these software pots, right? You undo all that. Let's turn the volume up on the snare. Okay. They all individually write control data, but when we move them from the matrix as pairs, they don't. You can hear the snare drum being affected. In this case, it's the snare, right? But it doesn't write control data. Watch. I'll move the matrix, and you'll see the pots here move. But when they're being moved by the matrix, they don't send out control data. Nothing. No control data. Again, MP1, moving the cutoff resonance. They don't write control data when they're moved as a pair from the pad. Even though you can hear the effect actually working on the snare. But they're not writing control data. And it's the same with MP2, the two auxiliaries. When moved as a pair from the pad, they don't write control data, it's on. Okay, so that doesn't work. Let me just reload 80 Studio Drums so that I get that snare back. Okay, so we're triggering Spark from patterns on its own track. The roller doesn't work at all, so forget that. That leaves us the filter and the slicer. So let's look at these two now. There's a particular way that you need to work to write these controllers in to your host sequencer when you're triggering Spark from patterns on its track, you know, and you're writing controllers onto the track. Okay, starting with the filter. Okay, now it's useless trying to write these filter moves in using the pad and touching it with your finger. It just doesn't work. Watch. It writes a little bit in, and then even though you can hear the filter working, Even though you can hear the filter working, it's not writing any more data. So it just writes this little cluster of data and then gives up. It's useless. Okay, and it's the same with the slicer as well. So this is how you write controllers to your host sequencer when you're using Spark as a plugin. First, we need to identify the controller. So we put our host sequencer into the mode where it records controllers, and then we don't touch the hardware anymore. We're going to use the effects pad now. What I'm going to do is, as my host sequencer is recording, I'm going to click the filter button to identify the filter, and then click on the pad and move it just once to capture a snapshot of all the controllers for the filter. Here we go. Touch the filter button, then move the filter control. That's it. I've captured all the parameters now. Here they are, four parameters. Master filter. That is the type of filter. Look at the line moving up and down. Band pass, high pass, Oberheim low pass, Oberheim band pass, Oberheim high pass, multimode 1, multimode 2. So we just need one node. So knock all the other nodes out. So there's just a node at the beginning. Okay, and now to change the filter type, we can either keep clicking on the filter button, and you'll see the line moving up and down as we change the filter type. Okay, that controller tells Spark what type of filter to play. We can change that filter type by repeatedly clicking on the button, and the line just moves to change the controller value. Or the other way we can do it is we hold down on the filter button with the left mouse, and then while still holding down with the left mouse, we try and drag the filter button across and drop it onto the pad. That's the action we're doing with the mouse. So we left click on the filter button, hold down with the left mouse, drag across onto the pad while still holding down with the left mouse. We can then go over the values and choose one directly rather than cycling round. So we'll choose the low pass filter. Okay. Then next we have the bypass value, which would have been written in when we touched the pad. And you get you'll get something that looks roughly like that. But we need to make a vertical in position and a vertical out position. Okay, now Logic's very fussy about the way it allows you to write in a vertical, directly vertical drop or rise. And we have to have it absolutely vertical. So we put our snap automation on. We'll put it into something like division or beat. Okay, with Logic, to write a downward and upward motion, it works like this. Okay, you always must put the node that's going to snap above the other or below the other node before the node that you're snapping above or below, like this. If you want to make a downhill movement where it goes from the top to the bottom in a perfect vertical line, you start with one node, drag it to the bottom till it reads 0.0, then you must put the node that's going to be snapped above it in front of it. Drag that to the top till it reads 1.0, let go of it, then drag it and snap it directly over the other one. That one can come out. That's our downhill vertical movement. To do it the other way round, we put in a node, push it all the way up to the top till it reads 1.0, and again, the node being snapped has to be in front of the node. So snap a node in front of that other node, drag it to the bottom till it reads 0.0, let go of it, grab it again and snap it directly under the other one, and we get a perfect vertical line. Okay, let me use the select tool in Logic to drag that pair of nodes, that vertical on position, to where we want it to come on and where we want the effect to go off. Okay, so my filter effect will come on there, go off there. Okay, the type of filter is there. That's the low pass, band pass, high pass, whatever. You choose the one you want. And then we finally have the cutoff and the resonance. Now we know from the bypass position our effect begins at the beginning of that region and ends at the end of that region. Okay, so now we get the cutoff. And we arrange our cutoff move, put a node at the end, put a node at the beginning, and arrange our cutoff move in between. If you need to turn the snap off to make finer movements, go for that, of course. Okay, there's our cutoff move in between the start and end position. Then our resonance move. again, a node at the beginning, a node at the end, and then we put in, oops, then we put in our resonance move. Like that. Okay, so we've got our resonance move, our cutoff move, the type of filter set at the moment to low pass, and then there's the in position and the out position for the filter. Okay, and that's it, that's all we do. So here we go, here's the filter. Okay, from the top. Simple as that, and then you just change the start and end position, modify your curves for the cutoff and resonance as required. Then all you do is you just choose a different type of filter. Oberheim band pass. The line moves up to tell Spark to do an Oberheim band pass. We go to the bypass, an Oberheim band pass, sorry. Then we next go and choose the bypass facility, check our start and end positions, and then it's the same thing as before. We can adjust our cutoff and resonance move in between the start and end position. And this time we're doing an Oberheim bandpass filter. Okay, which comes on there, goes off there. Here we go. Simple as that. All you have to do, change the type of filter. Let's choose the high pass filter. Again, set your end position, your start position, and then adjust your curves. Got a cutoff and resonance in between. Do what you like, you know. Here we go. High pass this time, so let me. Here we go. Okay, simple as that. Okay, so you just, that's it. That's your filter. Alright, let's remove the track automation, all of it, from completely, get rid of it. Okay, that's the filter. Next, the slicer. This has more parameters, but it's the same thing. We don't write it in from the pad. We capture the controllers and then arrange them manually. So, same thing. Put it into record for controllers, your host sequencer, and then we're going to touch the, we switch from filter to slicer, and then we're going to touch the value and touch the slicer button, and that'll get all our parameters in while it's recording controllers. Here we go. Touch the value, touch the button, done. We've got all our parameters in. Now the slicer only has three parameters. The filter has four parameters: cutoff, resonance, the on and off position, and the type of filter. But the slicer only has three values. The type of slicer effect, that's repeat, tape, reverse, strobe, pan, mix, or bit crusher. And then all it has is the value of the effect and the on and off position. So if we choose repeat, then we get the values of quarter, 3/16, 8/16, 30 seconds, or 64ths. If we choose tape, we get how many bars it takes to slow down. If we choose the bit crusher, we get to choose how many bits. See what I mean? So we'll choose repeat first. So this is the type of effect. We only need one node at the beginning. Okay, so again, left click on the slicer button while holding down, drag across, and we can choose the type of effect while holding down with the left mouse. So we choose repeat. Next thing, the bypass. We need to set up the start and end position as shown before. Right to the top, put a node underneath it, drag it right to the bottom, let go, snap it underneath. Boom. Use the select tool. Okay, so our repeat effect is going to begin there and end there, and it's a repeat effect, and then we just choose the value, quarter, and again this line only needs to have one node, only one node at the very beginning, so we could choose the quarter, 3/16, 8/16, 30 seconds, 64, so we'll start with a quarter. Okay, a quarter slicer, and it begins there, goes off there. Here we go. Wait, but wait, you say to yourself, nothing's happening. And yeah, it took me a while to figure this out because The first time I did it, it worked. Then when I came back to start doing a video showing how to do it a few days ago, it didn't work. And I couldn't figure out why it worked the first time and why it didn't work the next time I came back, and I discovered what it was. If you're sequencing Spark from notes on its track on the host sequencer, we're not playing the internal pattern sequencer, but we want to do slicer control moves from the track, we have to have the sequencer running, Spark sequencer, but we need an empty pattern. So if I just choose, say, D, come on, D16, empty the pattern. D16 is now empty. I will now play pattern D16 from Spark's sequencer. Press play, here we go. Come on, there we go. Empty pattern. Now we sync Spark's pattern sequencer running this empty pattern. For some reason, the slicer effect, for it to work, Spark's pattern sequencer has to be running, but it's still being triggered from notes on its own track. We're not triggering Spark from patterns in its own pattern sequencer, but the pattern sequencer does need to be running. So set up an empty pattern, synchronize Spark, and now your slicer effect will work. Here we go. Yeah, simple as that. And then you just change the start position to try getting capturing different slices. Let's move this forward 2/16. Here we go. Whoa. And we capture a different slice. Let's try moving it forward a whole quarter beat. In Logic, to do this, you need your snap automation on. You choose division. Okay. So we've moved the start position now a full quarter beat into the bar. Let's hear what that does, which slice that captures. See what I mean? So you just experiment with the start time. When you got it going with a good slice that you like, and then set your out point so it comes out of it nicely, and then all you do is change the value of the slicer. Let's choose 3/16. The line moves up, tell Spark to do 3/16. Okay, let's have it starting on the first beat of the bar like that. Here we go. Okay, now sometimes with these effects you need to put the metronome on to hear if rhythmically they're working. Let's move this forward. We're doing 3/16, so let's move the start position in 3/16 into the beginning of the bar. Here we go. Yes. Yeah, nice cross rhythm there. See, so it's about adjusting the start time to get a good rhythm. Then set your out point so it comes out nicely. And then you just change the slicer value, 30 seconds, whatever. Yeah, same thing. Logic always knocks the last node out if the playhead is past the last node when you adjust a different parameter. It's so annoying. You have to always remember to move Logic's playhead back past the last node. Okay, we're doing, what are we doing now? I can't even remember the value now. 16ths, I think it is. Here we go. See what I mean? And then you just adjust the start position. Okay, next slicer effect. Hold down slicer with the left mouse. While holding down, drag across, still holding down with the left mouse. Then you can choose the one you want. So choose, look at the yellow line moving as we choose the different type of slicer effect. Choose tape, the next one. Tape. Here's our values. 8 bars, 4 bars, 2 bar, 1, half or a quarter. So we start with 8. But the thing I've noticed is that this effect doesn't work to the same pattern or bar count as the host sequencer. If we choose 8 bars for the tape slowdown in Spark, we actually get 4 bars of tape slowdown in the host. It's half, so I'll choose 4 bars for the tape slowdown. Okay, again, Logic's knocked the node out because I forgot to move the playhead back. Okay, we're doing 4 bars of tape slicing, of tape slowdown. Okay, shall it'll begin there, and it will end there. And we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 bars. But what you'll find is, if I select 4 bars, we'll actually get 2 bars of slowdown here. Okay, so here we go. Tape slowdown. 4 bars of. One, two. That's it. Now, if you have got like two bars of tape slowdown, which is actually four bars, and trust me, it's nothing to do with the pattern sequencer. I've tried changing the pattern sequencer to 4/4, whatever. I've tried changing all these values. It doesn't matter what you've got them set to. For some reason, the slicing effect the tape slowdown is whatever it says in how many bars it'll do it here. It's half on the host sequencer. So if I chose 8 bars, I'll get a 4-bar slowdown here on my host. Watch. Okay, the other thing to notice, if we choose, for example, 2 bars, which will give us 1 bar of tape slowdown on our host sequencer, then what happens is, oh god, there's that bloody node being knocked out again. What happens is, okay, now we're doing 2 bars in Spark for tape slowdown, which equals 1 bar in a host sequencer. So the effect here starts, the tape slows down, stop. But if the off value for the effect here, where the bypass turns off, okay, or turns on rather, so the effect begins here and ends there. But the tape slowdown stops there. But if there's a gap between the end of the tape slowdown and where the effect turns off, Spark remains silent. Okay? Watch. Here we go. One bar! And then Spark just stays silent until the off position of the effect. And on it comes again. See what I mean? So you could do this. You could move the off position to be just... So now we've got 2 bars, but the effect only lasts 1 bar. Here we go. So we get 1 bar of tape slowdown, 1 bar of silence. Back it comes. Okay, that's tape. Next one. Hold down on the slicer button. Drag across. Choose reverse. Okay, our reverse effect is going to come on there, it's going to go off there, then we choose the value. 1 bar, half a bar, quarter. Let's choose a quarter. Here we go. Oh god, Logic's knocked that node out again. I hate Logic so much. Okay. I wonder if I put a node further on, whether it would stop doing that. Anyway, here we go. We're doing reverse effect at, what was it? A quarter bar. Here we go. Now that did not work very successfully, did it? So you know what? I'm noticing that line is not really vertical. I'm going to re-put that node in. Hang on. It didn't look vertical to me. It has to be absolutely vertical, the line. Oh god, what is going on with Logic's controllers? Are just terrible. Can you please snap? I don't want to put 2 nodes in. I put 1 node in. I drag it up to the top. Thank you. Oh, snap. Snap. It's not working. Oh, I know why. I'm doing it back to front. No, I'm not. This should work. This should work. You snap the node at the bottom. Like that. You snap another node in front of it. Drag it up to the top. Let go of it, drag it across, snap it over the other one. There we go. Right. Effect coming on there, going off there. And we are doing the reverse effect at a value of a half. Now let's do 1 bar. 1 bar of reverse effect coming on there, going off there. Here we go. Wasn't very rhythmic, that one. You might find with the reverse effect it's good to put the metronome on to judge whether the reverse effect is in time. That wasn't in time, I could tell anyway, without the metronome. So we get the selector, we move the start position. Let's move it forward. I need slightly wider zoom to see the 16ths. There we go. Let's move it forward. 1/2 16ths. Here we go. Reverse effect at 1 bar value. Yes. Yes. And then you get a good rhythmic effect. So always experiment with the start time. Then set the end time for the effect so that it comes out of it nicely. Okay? And to change your value, just change it here. So we'll change it to quarter beats. Boom. Quarter beats. Effect comes on there, goes off there. Actually, we'll have it come on exactly on the first beat of the bar. Quarter beats. Here we go. For reverse. Kind of worked. Let's move it forward 2/16ths. Here we go. Better. Yeah, so you see, every time you move it forward, you capture a different slice. Okay, so always experiment with the start time. Okay, just change your value, blah blah blah. Right, next effect. Hold down on the slicer. Next effect. Strobe. Again, there's your value. So we'll start with a quarter beat for the strobe. And then you just have your in and out point. Here we go. Strobe effect coming on here, going out there at quarter beats. Again, it's about changing the start position. Let's move it in a whole quarter beat. Here we go. See what I mean? Again, wherever the start position is affects which slice is captured, how it repeats, what the rhythmic quality is, etc. And then you just change to whatever value you want. So we'll try dotted quarters next. Here we go. Dotted quarter beats. Starting on the first beat of the bar. Here we go. Nice. See, so there you go. Just experiment, and always experiment with the start time. Okay, next slicer effect. Hold down on the left, with the left mouse on the slicer, while holding down, drag across, keep holding down. Pan. Pan effect at quarter beats. This just does a slicer, but it pans the slices left, right. So it starts here, ends there, quarter beats, here we go. And it's doing the same slicing effect. It's doing the same slicing effect there as when it does basic slicer, but it pans the slices left, right. So again, set it up, experiment with the start time, choose your value, etc. Slicer, hold down with the left mouse, drag across while holding down, keep holding down. Choose the next value. Mix. Mix. One bar of mix. Coming on there, going out there. Here we go. Etc. Try an eighth. 1/8 of mix. Coming on there, going out there. Here we go. Etc. Okay, that's mixed. Then again, hold down on the slicer button with the left mouse, click while holding down, drag, keep holding down, choose the next value, the bit crusher, the final value. Boom. Now this is not a rhythmic effect, we just choose the value of the bit crushing. I'll choose 2 bits, and it's just the same. Effect comes on there, goes out there. Here we go. Simple as that. Set your start time, set your end time. Okay, so there you go. That is how you use the effects pad to write controllers in your host sequencer. It doesn't really work writing it by hand from the pad. That works to write to pattern sequencer of Spark, yes. So if you want, write the effects into Spark's pattern sequencer. Then afterwards, in the library of Spark, export the pattern out with the effect already in it. You can do it that way, but you need to write control moves across multiple patterns, you see, which in Spark you can't do. Spark doesn't write controllers across multiple patterns, it writes the controllers inside the patterns themselves, you see. So we can write controllers across multiple patterns or regions in our host sequencer like that, for the effects pad, and that's how you do it, all right? Well, I hope that's been useful. There you go.